Glad to get to be here. All day today, I've thought about the scripture that as we were closing last night, Brother Chris quoted the scripture that was, our memory verse last year at our Bible camp, and I've had that on my heart today, and the Bible is, it says this in the book of Psalms, chapter number 139. I'd like to ask you to turn there. While you're turning to that, when she came to sing, the first thing she done was bowed her heart before God. But you'd understand that's a greater message than you'll hear preached anywhere. There's never an appointed time for you to pray. It's right now, just like Tommy said. If the Lord's dealing with your heart, right now is when you need to pray. If you're struggling with an issue, right now is the time for you to pray. It's not putting it off. And you a lot of times, let me tell you what I've been guilty of. You see someone in the grocery store and they have some type of issue, whatever that may be, and ask you to pray for it. Right now is the time to pray. Now then, I'll sure pray about that. When someone asks you, church, for prayer, right now is when they need it. Amen. Not when it's convenient for you, right now is whenever they need the prayer. And I want you to read with me this in the book of Psalms, and tonight I'd like for you to ask yourself or speak this yourself to Almighty God with all sincerity. Not just because the preacher told you to, but I'd like for you to speak this as yourself and take a look at yourself. Well, this is what God's Word said. This is what the scripture that Brother Chris was talking about last night as he was testifying before we closed. And it says this in the book of Psalms, 139, beginning at verse number 23, it says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Now then, if we all truly open ourselves up to God Almighty, if we truly open ourselves up and say, "Lord, tonight what I'd like for you to do is look inside me. Search what's in here. What I'd like for you to do, oh God, is know what's in my heart. Try me and, the things that I think about. I'd like for you to look those over, make sure that they're pleasing to you, and see if there be any wicked way in me and lead me in the way everlasting." I'd like for you to think about that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you tonight. We thank you and praise you that you allow us to be in your house. We thank you, Lord, that your spirit has absolutely no boundaries. We thank you, Lord, that wherever we come together in your name, that your spirit will be in the midst. We cry out for you tonight, begging you, Lord, that you fill this house with your spirit. Help us as your people to get connected to you. We don't want to be in a vain repetition tonight, Lord. We want to be focused on you, Lord, in one mind, one accord, giving you the glory and the honor for everything. Lord, guard my lips. Help me to not speak anything contrary to this word, know what to speak, most of all know when to hush, that your spirit would be able to move. If there's someone here that don't know you tonight, Lord, I pray, God, that you would truly, Lord, show them in their lives where they stand eternally, and I'll be faithful to give you the thanks and the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Now then, ask yourself that question that I've read to you three times. I'm going to read it one more time. He said, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Now then, what I'd like to try to preach tonight is looks can be deceiving. Looks can be deceiving. You know, I'm thankful that I have, I got my truck back today. I had the brakes went out on it one day last week, and I've got somebody that I really trust to work on my vehicle. I just take it and drop it off, and whatever he says wrong with it, that's what's wrong with it. I believe it. He fixed it. That's the way it is. But there is people that will deceive you, and they'll tell you whatever, and they'll just do whatever. That's the way that the world is. But what I'd like to try to preach tonight is looks can be deceiving, right here in the church house. We've got people in the church house that are faithful for all the things we can. My daddy was a preacher. I was a preacher's kid, but by the time that I got up and run around, I knew how to act around church people. If you've been in church, you know how to act around church people. Amen. Don't act like you don't. You're polite, respect your elders, all the things that you're supposed to do. Amen. This means yes, and this still means no. You know what I'm talking about. But looks can be deceiving. Friend, if you come tonight in just deception of the way that you are, and the looking like that you feel like that you should look as to present yourself as a Christian, I want you to understand that don't make you a Christian. What makes you a Christian is the blood of Jesus Christ being applied to your sins. That's the only way that you can become born again. If you'll turn with me into the book of Luke, chapter number 16, we're going to look at a couple of people here that the looks were deceiving in their lives. Chapter number 16, the book of Luke, beginning at verse number 19. The Bible says this, and it said that there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. Now, by all the world's standards, I want you to understand that purple whenever Jesus was here, that was a show of money. That was a show of prestige. Purple was a dye that was hard to come by. And whenever you wore purple, that meant that you were royalty, you were some great thing, and you had more than what society would normally have. It said this was a certain man which clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. He wasn't someone who was just out in the field working for what he was going to get that day. He had things going by his way by the world's standards. But what people would be able to see from him, all the things were going exactly the way that the way that he would have them to go. And the Bible says, and there was a certain bag. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Now then, society standards, here was a man that he had absolutely nothing. He didn't even have the ability, the Bible teaches us, he didn't even have the ability to get where he could be a beggar. Someone had to take him. Let me read to you what Jesus said. He said there was a certain man which was Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores. Somebody had to physically take this man and lay him at the gate. He didn't have anything. He didn't have transportation. He didn't have a way that he could get there. By society's eyes, he had absolutely nothing. You understand what I'm saying? Friend, I'm trying to preach tonight that looks can be deceiving. If you've got Jesus, it doesn't matter about the things of the world. He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. This is what Jesus said. He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and these things shall be added unto you. But we get things mixed up in our mind. Here was someone that by society's standards, purple, fine linen, he was faring sumptuously every day, had plenty to eat, and then here was this beggar. According to standards, the rich man had everything that there was, and the beggar, he was just existing. Hallelujah. Sometimes we look down at people with sin in their life. Hey, as people that are just existing, I want you to understand today, except for the grace of God, there would be no difference in you and the beggar. Do you understand that? Hallelujah. I want you to know that really and truly, we're nothing but beggars. When all we are is someone that's crying out, hey, that has sin in their life, asking for God, for a righteous Savior to save us from our sins. We ain't nothing but beggars, but if we're not careful as church people, we'll put ourselves up on a big high level. Amen. That's right. Really and truly, we're just beggars asking somebody named Jesus to take away our sin. The Bible says this. I'm trying to preach. Looks can be deceiving. It said, and it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. And the rich man also died and was buried. And the Bible, the very next thing that Jesus spoke in the book of Luke, chapter number 16, it said, and in hell he lift up his eyes. I want you to understand that you can come to church, you can put on your best tie. Kim got on to me last night because I had a handkerchief that wasn't iron. You can come to church with your handkerchief iron. You can make everything look just right, friend, and die and go to a devil's hell. Do you understand that? I want you to know tonight that hell is a real place. It's a literal lake of fire. Hey, it's real, and the Bible teaches us that that you're in torments forever. It said that the smoke will ascend forever. You'll never burn up in this lake of fire. Do you understand that? Hey, looks can be deceiving. You can come to church, put on your church smile, put on your church clothes. Hey, friend, and that's, let me promise you, that's not going to keep you out of a place called hell. The only thing that's going to keep you out of that place is the blood of the Lamb. Friend, there has to be. Without the shedding of blood, the Bible teaches us there's no remission of sin. Hey, the blood of the Lamb is what I'm talking about. Whenever Jesus came, whenever John was baptizing, Jesus came walking down through there, and he said, behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Friend, without the blood of the Lamb applied to your life, hell's where you're going. It doesn't matter. Looks can be deceiving. You can come to church and be the best little old church boy that you've ever been. I knew how to do that too. My daddy was the preacher. Remember me telling you about how mama used to whoop me? I figured out getting underneath that pew right in front. My mama always said about the second pew. When daddy was pastoring over at Shiloh, there was three rows of pews. And she said about the second or the third one back. Anyway, there was one in front of her. And I figured out, hey, if I'd scoot up in under that one in front of me, in front of her, and go to sleep, I wouldn't get a whooping that time. See? Looks can be deceiving. That mean the little boy was still asleep in God's house. Looks can be deceiving. You might come in and slide in, and you've got your place. We're all religious, right? We're parked in the same spot. Set in the same pew. That's right. We even know how many songs we're going to sing whenever service starts. Hey, we get religious about things. Friend, those things don't take you to heaven. The blood of the Lamb is what takes you to heaven. Do you understand that? Looks can be deceiving. The things that we do inside this house are supposed to be worship and praise for Him. Do you understand those things? He said, Jesus spoke and He said, the very first thing that He said in the 23rd verse, He said, and in hell, talking about the rich man, He said, he lift up his eyes and being in torments, he could see Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. See, by the world's standards, he had everything that the world had to offer. But friend, what does it profit a man if he gained the whole world, this is what Jesus said, and lose his own soul? Friend, the things of this world are going to burn up. Amen. The book of Peter says it's in a fervent heat. All of this is going to be wiped away. The things that has caused families divided, the things that have caused friendships to stop simply because there's a piece of dirt right here and we drove up a stub and my daddy said the line was there, but my daddy said it was over here. Friend, look here. Those type of things have divided people forever. Amen. That's right. All of this is going to wipe away. There's a new Jerusalem called heaven. I'm preaching about hell, but there's a new Jerusalem. It ain't right here. Do you understand that? He said, I saw a new Jerusalem coming down from out of heaven. That's what heaven's going to be. Do you understand those things? I'm trying to preach. Looks can be deceiving. You can come to church and have the perfect smile. You can come to church and have everything in order as far as church people supposed to have in order. You know what I'm trying to preach? You can look like you're supposed to look in church and still be dying and going to hell. Do you understand that? Now is the time to make things right with God. Right now is the time for you to make things right with God if you've never accepted Christ as your Savior. Not next week. Not next service. Right now. Jesus told us, He said, and he being in torment, he seeth a Lazarus afar off. and Lazarus afar off in his and in Lazarus in his bosom, and he cried and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me that he said, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame." Friend, I want you to also understand that this man that looked like he had everything going his way, he was covered by flame. That's what Jesus told us. In this place called hell, there's going to be a real flame. There's really going to be, it explains it like a lake of fire. You ever jumped in the lake? Anybody here been to the lake? You ever jumped in it? You're surrounded by that water. My Bible says it's going to be a lake of fire. Hey, the devil has also got some ways that he'll let looks be deceiving. He'll make you think that ain't what it's going to be like, Andy. That ain't what eternity is going to be without accepting the Son. But friend, that's exactly what it's going to be. You know, when you jump in that water, you're helpless. If you can't swim, there ain't nothing you can do. You're going in up over your head. If you can swim, if you're the very best swimmer that you are, I'll promise you, you can't get this much of you out of the water. You're going to be surrounded in a lake of fire. You're going to be surrounded in a flame. See, the devil will make the looks be so deceiving also. He's a loving God. I've heard people say that. He's a loving God. He won't send nobody to hell, friend. No, he won't, because he made a way. He sent his Son. His Son's name's Jesus. He made the sacrifice on a cross at Calvary, hey, so that you and I wouldn't have to go to this awful place. He was tormented in this flame. He said, just send him down here, that awful, sorry beggar that was laying at my gate that absolutely had nothing. Just send him down here and tell him dip his finger down in the water that he might cool my tongue. Not the rest of me, just this one little portion of my body. I want you to understand that's what kind of torment that it's going to be. He said, but Abraham said, Son, remember how that thou in thy lifetime receiveth thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. If you'll read your Bible, Jesus just keeps telling us that it's torments, tormented, tormented. But the devil will paint sin so pretty in this world. He'll make everything look so good that it can't really be like that. Friend, looks can be deceiving. Do you understand that? Amen. Looks can be deceiving. He said, and beside all this, between us and you, there's a great gulf fixed so that they which would pass from thence to you cannot, and neither can they pass that they can pass to us that would come from thence. I want you to understand that eternity is something that we really don't even understand. Do you know that? Eternity is really the absence of time. We're all on a schedule. I guarantee you that all of you looked at your clock whenever you started getting ready to come to church tonight. Amen, you did. We had a time set aside to come here. We, from the very, as far back as I can remember funerals. I can remember death in my life. Like I said, my daddy was a preacher. I had to go to the hospital. I had to go to funeral. I had to do all that kind of stuff. I can remember from a little bitty child knowing that death was coming. Friend, I want you to understand whenever eternity comes, that's forever. There's no more death. It's eternity forever, whether you're in heaven or whether you're in hell. There's an absence of time. Amen. Playing church is the most dangerous thing that you've ever done. Amen. Pretending like that you're a Christian to fit in is the most dangerous thing that you've ever done. You know why? Because in a while you'll begin to deceive yourself. You'll begin to, the devil will tell you how good that you're doing, how well things is going in your life since you got in church. I'm not saying don't go to church. I'm a preacher. I want you to go to church, I promise. Friend, coming to church don't make you a Christian. Once you get in this place called hell, it's for eternity. There's no turning back. There's no getting out. And then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send to my father's house, and I have five brethren, that they may testify also, lest they also come to this place of torment. I'm going to say that there's probably some pretty good preaching in hell. There's probably some pretty good testimonies in this place called hell, crying out to God, asking forgiveness. But you know what's gone at that point? Your grace is gone. Right now you have grace. For by grace, the grace of God, because He sent His Son, for by grace are you saved through your faith. Friend, if you've put your faith in anything else other than Jesus Christ, you don't have your faith in the right place. Do you understand that? I got faith that if I leave here and I go to Birdstown, I've got faith that bridge is going to be standing whenever I get on it. Three of us has. I got faith whenever I go back toward Livingston. When I go up Big Springs Hill, there's going to be a road for me to go up there. Amen? Yeah, amen. I know that that's going to be there. Do you know that Jesus has made atonement for your sins? That's what faith is. Amen. Do you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that the blood of the Lamb has been applied to your sins? I got faith that bridge is there. I got faith that road's there, and I got faith that Jesus took my place. I got faith that His blood made atonement to you. I told you to ask yourself these questions, if I can find it again. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Ask yourself that. Open your heart up to God tonight. You're already at church. We might as well have it. He said, I have five brethren. For I have five brethren that he may testify unto them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went from the dead, they'll repent. And he said unto them, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one be rose from the dead. I want to tell you about a man named Jesus. We're fixing to celebrate on the third day He rose from the dead. Just a few more Sundays, we're going to celebrate Easter Sunday. That's when our Savior Jesus rose from the dead. Because that He rose from the dead, because of that third day, you and I have life everlasting. You and I have an opportunity to be in a place called heaven because He rose again. He made atonement for our sins on the cross of Calvary. He became the sacrifice. But because He rose again, glory to God, that's how you and I are going to have an opportunity to rise again. Do you understand that? Everything is through Jesus. Without Jesus, I'm telling you, if you put your faith in anything else, you absolutely have no hope. If you put your faith in the church that you go to, you have no hope. If you put your faith in the job that you have no hope. If you put your faith in the salvation that the preacher's got, you have no hope. Except you have your faith in Jesus Christ, you absolutely have no hope. Do you understand that? There's a place called hell for people that have these looks that are deceiving. I got some good news to go along with this place called hell. In the book of John, in the third chapter, this is what Jesus spoke to Nicodemus. He told him, Nicodemus came to him in the middle of the night, and he was a ruler of the Jews. Hey, he was one that got to wear the long robes. He was somebody in church. He was somebody that knew exactly what the law was. Friend, looks can be deceiving. He'd been in and around church his whole life, but he had never accepted the Lamb. Do you understand that? He said, we know that that no man can do these miracles except God be with him. He come to Jesus and begin to tell him that. And Jesus told him, he said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except ye be born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. That's a level playing field. That's for everybody. Do you understand that? It doesn't matter how deceiving your looks have been. Except you've been born again, friend, you're not going to enter in. Here's the golden truth. Either you're a sinner or a saint. There ain't no middle ground. Either you are or you ain't. It's just that plain. You can't be part sinner and part Christian. It don't work like that. Either you're born again or you're not. Search me, O God. How do you stand tonight? How are you with an almighty God? Has your name been written in the book of life? Because at the end of everything, really, that's all that matters. When we end what we know as life and eternity begins, the only thing that truly matters is knowing that you have your name written in the Lamb's book of life. Things of this world, you're not going to have any... The possessions that you have no control over it then. Somebody else is going to do something with it, whatever that something is. So have you deceived the people that you go to church with? Have you put on your church face over and over and over? There's a song that talks about happy little plastic people with our happy little plastic steeple. Friend, looks can be deceiving. What's important is having the blood applied to your life. Here's the good news about that place called hell. You don't have to go there. Jesus, God sent His Son, and His Son's name is Jesus. And the Bible says that He was telling Nicodemus, He said, you must be born again. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And he was having a conversation with him, and Jesus told him, He said, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. But friend, you have an opportunity to enter the kingdom of God. It's through and by His Son named Jesus. It tells us in the 15th verse, it says, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have eternal life. I want you to understand, with the perishing that He's talking about is that place called hell, that literal lake of fire that I just told you about, that the rich man went to, the one that looked like he had everything, but whenever he died in hell, he lifted up his eyes. Friend, I don't want you to be deceived into thinking that just coming to church and doing the churchy things that you've learned over your life is going to get you to heaven. It's the blood of the Lamb. Jesus said this. He said, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever... Do you understand that? It doesn't mean how... It doesn't matter how bad you've been. It doesn't matter what's went on in your life. You're a whosoever. He sent His Son just for you. He didn't want you to go to a place called hell. Even if your looks have been deceiving, year after year after year, He still loves you. Whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. He that believeth on Him is not condemned. Listen to this. But he that believeth not is condemned already. Because you don't have that faith in Jesus Christ like you've got, whether you admit it or not. If you go to Birdstown, you've got faith, you're going to make it across that bridge. You do. If you go back toward Livingston, you've got faith, that road's going to be there for you to go up Big Springs Hill. Because you don't have that kind of faith in Jesus Christ, it's why you're not going to heaven. How much plainer can that be? Getting all those thoughts that you've learned to deceive people with out of your head and down into your heart. That's believing. That's believing on the Lamb of God. He that believeth on Him is not condemned already, but he that believeth not is condemned already because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God.